Today, Mavis launched a long overdue major update to their pro video app with the release of Mavis V7, rebranding it as Mavis Camera. And shame about the timing, as just over a month ago, Mavis, or what is now discontinued and known as Mavis Camera Classic, joined the pro video app Wall of Shame in my video on the best apps for pro video in 2025, which you can watch up here. Due to it being abandoned for a very long time and missing key features like Apple Log. The all-new Mavis Camera V7 is free to download with a Pro Pack available as a one-time in-app purchase, which includes Frame.io camera to cloud support, timecode UltraSync Blue support, and very impressive advanced audio functionality for just $14.99. Mavis Camera to Cloud is an additional daily or monthly subscription if you require their cloud workflow, and I really like that they have added a one-off Buy Us a Coffee in-app purchase too, so you can show your support for this incredible app and help keep it free. Well, I'm happy to report that Apple Log is finally available in Mavis Camera V7, along with a ton of other good stuff, including live streaming, incredible monitor tools, and much more. But it's also missing some key features available in the earlier version. So in this tutorial, I'm going to take you through everything that is new, and by the end, you'll know just how this fares against other pro video apps in 2025. Let's dive in and learn how to use Mavis Camera. First thing to note is that Mavis V7 finally adds support for both landscape and portrait filming. Previously, it was landscape only, so this is great news. Mavis V7 segments the interface based on three layers of control. The primary controls are comprised of the record button, custom function button with the default action being set to show files, cloud streaming settings, thumb rails for manual focus and exposure control, lens selector and zoom, and monitor tools which offer advanced assists such as focus peaking and false color, and the primary controls are always accessible and can be changed even during a recording. The secondary camera controls are comprised of the camera control wheel, which can be accessed by tapping the dedicated camera button or by long pressing anywhere in the preview, audio tools accessed via the audio button, and the monitor tools customization options, which can be accessed by tapping the monitor tools button, enabling a monitor tool like focus peaking, and then tapping and holding to access customization options. These are all secondary menus that can be overlaid on the main interface as needed. And the third layer of controls is the settings and files library, which are accessed from the More menu. And while we're here, let's jump into settings to configure Mavis for capture. Under Input, tap on Camera Settings, and under Video Format, we can select our capture resolution. I'll set this to 4K. Next, let's set our frame rate, and Mavis delivers all the frame rates you could want, including 23.98, 24fps, PAL frame rates, as well as high-speed frame rates. You can even set a custom frame rate, which is a unique feature. I'll select 24fps and return to camera settings. Next, we can choose color space, and Mavis V7 finally supports Apple Log in addition to SDR and HDR. I'll choose Apple Log. Under Lens Selection Mode, Mavis by default will only show lenses that support your selected settings, which is another unique feature, and great if you want your settings to persist as you change lenses. If a given lens doesn't support your frame rate or resolution, for example, it simply won't be available to choose. If you're happy for certain values to be reset when unsupported on a given lens, you can choose Auto Switch Format if required. However, I recommend you leave this at the default to ensure that your recording conforms to your specified settings. Next, under Record and Stream, we can set our codec, and we can capture an Apple Log in H.264, HEVC, and Apple ProRes 422. Unfortunately, Mavis does not support variants of ProRes, so if you wanted to save some space in ProRes LT, that is not currently an option. I'll choose HEVC and tap back. We'll leave our output resolution set to match input and tap quality, where we can set our bitrate for HEVC encoding. I'll choose extreme, time code all set to time of day, and this can be a great way to quickly sync multiple iPhones in post, but UltraSync Blue and Atom X Sync are also supported. Time code is included in the Pro Pack in-app purchase. For display type, I'll change this from time code to duration and tap back. Next, we have custom controls, and this is really cool and not something I've seen in any other app. You can not only define what the function button in the main interface does, by default it's set to files, but you get over a dozen options, but you can also customize the volume up and the volume down and camera control buttons. I'll set volume up to false color for fast exposure checks and leave volume down at its default. We can also completely disable camera control if needed, but with this on, you can control exposure, zoom, and focus in Mavis. And lastly, you can set up your monitor tools, and this is extensive, and we will circle back to these in a minute. With our settings configured, tap Done to exit. Now, it's worth mentioning that currently, Mavis Camera does not support presets, so there's no way to save these settings for quick recall later. Hopefully this is added in a future update, but until then you'll need to dive back into settings should you need to make any changes, or you can tap the respective value in the info overlay at the top of the interface to jump straight to frame rate, for example. However, these buttons are tiny, so can be a little tricky to engage, especially in bright conditions. Now let's look at camera controls. First, use the lens selector to choose your lens. I want the 1X, but Mavis supports all available lenses on my 16 Pro Max. Next, let's set our focus and exposure. By default, we are in full auto mode, and this is signified by the auto buttons beneath the two thumb rails, with exposure on the left and focus on the right. We can tap anywhere in the interface to set a new point of interest, and if we want to lock the current exposure value, tap on the auto button beneath the exposure thumb rail, and to lock your current auto focus value, tap on auto beneath the focus thumb rail. No further changes will be made until we either manually adjust the ISO thumb rail or the focus thumb rail, or tap the auto button to re-enter auto mode. By default, the exposure thumb rail is set to act as an EV slider. This means you can apply exposure compensation while remaining in auto exposure, which is a really nice feature, perfect for counteracting your phone's tendency to overexpose when in auto mode in certain lighting conditions. We can easily access manual ISO control by disabling auto on the exposure thumb rail, but what if you want to adjust your shutter speed or angle manually? Well, to do this, you can either tap on the camera icon to reveal the camera control wheel, or a much faster way to access this is just to long press anywhere in the camera preview and it will appear beneath your thumb, then tap exposure and then shutter. Here you can select your shutter speed via the wheel, or you can use angle, making it easier to get filmic motion blur with a 180-degree shutter. I will say this feels a little fiddly. Could be nice if they added quick presets or some haptic feedback or snapping to common values, but it gets the job done. We can tap outside to close. Now we can use the exposure thumb rail to adjust ISO with our shutter speed locked. Mavis does not offer a shutter priority mode, so you can't leave your ISO set to auto. If we do tap the auto button, both ISO and shutter speed are reset to full auto mode. Next, let's look at the camera control wheel, which is a core part of the camera UX. If we long press to reveal the camera control wheel, we get access to additional settings and key functionality. For example, if we tap on Tools, we can actually change the layout of the thumb rails and place both on the left or right side of the interface, or split them across the center. The camera control wheel makes a number of other really useful settings and functions available to us. Under Tools, you can turn stabilization on or off. You can enable the torch as well as adjust its intensity, as well as adjust the zoom settings. I'll enable Pinches Servo and set the servo speed to slow for incredibly smooth zooms in the main camera UI just by pinching in and out. We can also long press and use the camera control wheel to quickly return to full auto, as well as manually set our white balance. either by setting from scene, which will sample the scene then lock our white balance, or manually via Kelvin and tint controls, we can reset to auto just by tapping auto here. Next, let's look at the custom function button, which by default is set to open your files library. We can change this, however, by long pressing on it and choosing from any of the available custom functions. I'm going to set this to set white balance. This way I can set and lock my white balance with a single tap from the main UI, which is a great time saver. Just put a white balance card like this one in the frame and tap, and your white balance is locked. I do wish the white balance state was reflected in the UI somewhere, so you could quickly tell if it is in auto or locked, but maybe that will come in a future update. Next, let's look at Mavis's monitor tools, which are incredibly powerful. Here you get the ability to toggle on focus peaking, expanded focus, false color, zebras, scopes, guide, image flip, aspect ratio, audio meters, and the info overlay. And you can enable as many of these at the same time as you like. If you long press on a monitor tool, you get access to customization quick settings. For example, for focus peaking, we can change the strength and the color. For expanded focus, you can adjust the magnification strength. And for false color, you can choose between a false color gradient, ranges, or blue only. Zebras allow you to define the threshold as well as the color, which is incredible. And for scope, you can choose between waveform, vector scope, or both. Guides offer thirds, portrait safe, ideal if you intend to crop your landscape video for portrait, as well as square, and the ability to adjust line thickness. All your monitor tools support additional customization via a long press. And you can also show or hide the available monitor tools shown here by tapping on Settings and scrolling to Monitor Tools. For example, if you never use Image Flip, you can tap it and disable Show in Monitor Tools. We can tap back and can add a second Zebra B, which is hidden by default, and change this to blue and set the start value to 5% and the end value to 10% to help us identify underexposure. The monitor tools are really best in class in Mavis Camera and better than any other iPhone app. Next, let's look at the advanced audio tools Mavis offers as part of the Pro Pack in-app purchase. First, let's make sure that the audio meter overlay from monitor tools is enabled. If we tap this, it will reveal the audio controls. You can also access this by tapping the dedicated audio button. At the top, you can enable or disable headphone monitoring if you have headphones connected. In the lower right, you can choose your audio input. I have the DJI Mic 2 wireless receiver attached, so I'll select that. It is paired with two DJI Mic transmitters, with one on the left channel and the other on the right channel of a stereo track. What is amazing about Mavis is you can tap to mute a microphone input, and if you tap the mixer, we can even adjust how the inputs are panned, as well as adjust the input levels independently. And if we select ISO, we can record each channel as an independent audio track that is embedded in the video file. Just record arm each channel and start a recording. Then when you bring this into your NLE, not only will you have your stereo audio tracks as per usual, but you get lossless dedicated tracks for each input, allowing you to mix them independently. Worth the in-app purchase alone. Really impressive. And beyond this, it also supports multi-channel audio interfaces with support for up to 8 individual input channels, which is astounding. Next, let's look at live streaming, which is unique to Mavis Camera and not available in any of the other third-party Pro Video apps. To get started, tap on the Cloud button. Here is where you can set up Mavis C2C or Adobe Frame.io Camera to Cloud, both of which require an active subscription to use, but we want to tap on Streaming. You will need to create a free Mavis Cloud account to use this feature, but as I've already done this and I'm signed in, I can choose my destination, and I'm going to choose YouTube Live. Then on YouTube, you would set up a new live stream and then paste your unique stream key here and give your stream a description and tap save. Now we can initiate a local recording, and when we're ready to go live, tap on the cloud button and start streaming. And now we have our high quality local recording on device, as well as our live stream going out to our favorite platform. Really cool. Lastly, let's look at importing our footage for editing and sharing. All video is saved internally to Mavis's library, which can be accessed by tapping the More button, then Files. If you want to copy a clip to the Photos app, swipe from left to right, then tap Share and save video. If you want to import to your Mac, just connect your iPhone. In the Finder, click on it, then select Files, and under Mavis you'll find your Recordings folder, which you can copy across to your computer, all ready for editing. So now that we've covered the app's incredible core feature set, it's worth talking about which features are missing in V7.0. First and foremost is LUT support. You cannot import any LUTs for display in the preview or recording directly to the clip. This is a real shame, as it means you can't go live in Apple Log, as the stream is also output in Apple Log. It would be great if you could record locally in Apple Log and apply a LUT to your stream output so it looks good. Secondly, as mentioned earlier, no presets yet. You can't save settings and quickly recall them. Mavis Camera Classic had great presets, so hopefully these return soon. Thirdly, currently it does not support recording to external SSD drives, but no doubt this will be added in the future. And finally, they have axed Apple Watch support, which was in Mavis Camera Classic. I hope they bring it back here. If you want Apple Watch support, then the native camera app from Apple or the Moment Pro camera app are your only options. Mavis Camera V7 is truly impressive. The base free offering is excellent, and the Pro Pack in-app purchase offers truly impressive functionality at a bargain one-time price. This has the best professional audio functionality of any Pro Video app, along with the best monitor tools. And as the only Pro Video app to offer live streaming, here it is in a league of its own. If the developers can add support for LUTs and custom presets, it will be able to rival Blackmagic Camera in many areas. But until that time, it is missing some really key functionality. But hats off to the developers. With V7 of Mavis Camera, they are coming off the Pro Video Wall of Shame and are in the running for one of the best Pro Video apps on iPhone in 2025. Definitely give this a download and buy the devs a coffee, along with the Pro Pack to support future updates. Thanks for watching. If this video helped, like, share, and subscribe. Drop your questions below, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.